Terri Nunn, Realtor at Sotheby's, proudly presents Ken Boxer Live.
I'm Terri Nunn, and you're watching Ken Boxer Live with Tai Babilonia.
From the American Riviera in Santa Barbara, California, it's Ken Boxer Live with your host, Ken Boxer, and co-host, two-time Olympian Tai Babilonia. Please welcome Ken and Tai.
Another full house.
Another full house because of this guest.
I love it.
Welcome. Oh, yeah. You're watching the show, Ken Boxer Live. I have to introduce you to my very talented and very lovely guest host. I should say guest host, my co-host, Tai Babilonia.
Thank you. Thanks, Ken.
I'm so nervous with my guest tonight. Our guest, I didn't even
mention. You're nervous?
Yes. Two-time Olympian, five-time national champion, as well as a world champion figure skater.
Thank you.
What's happening with you?
Oh my gosh, about a week, maybe a week and a half ago, Dave Gonzalez, who is in the audience tonight, he connected me with the Unity Shop here in Santa Barbara. And we had a, and Rabin and Adi and I had a great tour of the whole facility. I offered for their auction, two private half-hour skating lessons for people to bid on.
And I know you don't give those out very often. You never
no, I don't.
Do.
I've
been trying to hit you up for that for
years. I know, but this is so special. So the telethon is December 12th, the Unity Telethon, the 29th year, I think, that they've been doing this. So I'm so excited and so honored to be a part of it.
Well, good luck with
Thank
that.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you. All right. The woman made me nervous tonight because it's.
Did you have a hot flash too?
Not quite.
I think you did earlier. I get them all the time.
Tell us who is on the show.
Well, okay. I'm thrilled that we reconnected. Singer, actress, the lead vocalist of Berlin, a former figure skater. Did you know that?
I didn't know that.
I'm thrilled that she's with us tonight. Terri Nunn is in the studio tonight. I can't believe it. Yay! So don't go away. We'll be right back with Terri Nunn.
Ken Boxer Live, brought to you in part by Palazzo Restaurant, where people don't leave hungry or thirsty. Harbor View Inn. Welcome to Santa Barbara's premier four-diamond luxury boutique oceanfront hotel. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. Now back to Ken Boxer Live.
Thank you. Thank you so very much. Thank you. And we are back. Tonight's guest is the very talented singer and actress whose talents as the lead singer in the new wave band Berlin has made her one of the most recognizable musical talents around the world. Most of you know the band's mega hits Take My Breath Away, No More Words, The Metro, and Sex. And Berlin's most recent album entitled Animal has had rave reviews. Ladies and gentlemen, let's now welcome the very talented Terri Nunn.
So thrilled to see you.
Okay, this is
Here's
so
my
weird.
I know. Okay.
I
know.
Give you a handshake.
Oh, I
Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
It's okay.
Oh, yeah, Ken Boxer.
You know each other.
Oh, yeah, him.
Yeah, him.
Anyway, so.
I know.
You. Okay.
Let's talk skating.
Okay, so
let's go back.
I was 12 years old. My family moved to Santa Monica for the rink that was there because it was huge and it had good coaches.
Right, on 5th and Broadway.
She was God. On that rink. She was so famous and so huge, and I was nobody, and I wasn't very good. I sucked at competition.
Really?
Yes.
See, I don't remember you competing,
Terrible.
But I do, but
Awful.
I remember Terri.
How far did you, no, you don't even want to go there.
Where
do you remember
but
Terri?
But I remember her, not on the ice, but I always saw her outside the rink. There was like a brick wall that we would, something we would sit on. Yeah. And she was there with her guitar.
Yes.
And my other friend, Teresa Foy,
who was also a god,
a great skater,
she was a great skater,
was writing, and they were working on songs. So this was like 73, 74, 73, 74.
Yeah.
And then I didn't see her.
And I had a crush on your guy.
And she had a crush on Randy.
On Randy.
I heard from Teresa, there you go. There you go.
I told him that,
and he blushed.
I wanted him.
He's so cute.
It was heartbreaking to find out that he was gay, and I was like, okay, that's it.
Yeah. Oh, well.
Did he know? Did Randy ever find out?
No.
I don't think back then.
No, I didn't have the guts to talk to him.
But Teresa told him.
So, she did?
Yeah, she did.
Oh, God.
So fast forward to, like, the US Festival, which I was there, and I saw her, and I called Teresa. I go, Teresa, is that the same Terri as the Terri from the rink? She goes, yes, and she has a crush on Randy.
Wow.
And that's you know.
So you were there that day.
Yes.
God, that was, it's still an amazing
day. Amazing.
It was
so much fun.
Glenn, David Bowie, Stevie Nicks, Pretenders.
I was there with Stevie.
You two. This is just that day.
Yes. Amazing.
And then there was the heavy metal day.
Yeah.
And then there was the new wave day. I don't know why we didn't get
Missing
put on
Persons
that one.
And.
Yeah, and yeah. Excess.
But they don't have those anymore, right?
Steve Wozniak, who I interviewed on my radio show.
KCSN. Ooh, that's a good one.
We did an US Festival day. He lost $9 million on the US Festival.
What?
And didn't care.
Yeah, chump change, right?
He said, it's my party, and I want to do this, and it's to this day. There's never been anything like it.
Okay, but before the ice skating, were we talking high school time? Was this when you were ice skating?
No, I was 13.
1973. Yeah, we were kids.
Did you have any acting? Classes yet?
No, I
started. Because you started as an actress.
Yeah, in television. I did episode Lou Grant and Mary Hartman.
James at 15.
I
saw that
what
one.
Also, Police Story. Just, a lot of episodic stuff.
But somehow it managed to go from acting to music. But you also, before we get into your musical career, you...
The audition.
The audition for Star Wars. A lot of our viewers, I know you've probably talked about this a lot, but people can see on YouTube your audition with Harrison Ford.
And it was good, Terri.
It was?
I thought it was great.
Well,
you were prepared. I mean, you did your homework.
How did you get the audition?
It was literally like two deck chairs. Harrison was in one, and George Lucas was in the other. And here's the script. And here's R2-D2 and Chewbacca, and we're the phasers. We have to run. I don't know what the Chewbacca is, or an R2-D2.
Right.
Yeah, so I'm just trying to get into it, and Harrison could give a...
Didn't he have the part already?
He didn't like me. He was just kind of doing it, talking and... So,
I saw an interview, tried to get him involved in your scene. He just wasn't going to even be a part of it.
No,
he just not there.
No, he wasn't there.
Now, he had done American Graffiti by then?
He had not done anything.
Oh, so he was just a...
Oh, I didn't know that.
He was working on George Lucas's kitchen at the time. He was a carpenter. And he told George, I'm an actor, too. And George said, okay, why don't you come down and you can read with everybody, because I need to read all these actors. So he said, okay. So he read with everyone.
But how did you get the chance to even read?
Because I was an actor, so I went in on things. I was pretty
good. Did you have an agent?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was pretty good.
Okay, you worked a lot.
Looking back.
Yeah, I did. Mm-hmm. I did a lot of television.
But when some door closed, another door opens, right? So Berlin comes about. How did that happen?
Well, actually, what made Berlin come about was I don't know if you remember the show Dallas?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So... For some reason, the casting director knew me and brought me in, and they offered me the role that Charlene Tilton eventually did. But it was a 7-year contract, and I had to decide right then. And then I just realized, okay, my life's either going to be an actor or I'm going to try the singing thing, the music thing over here. Because in those days, you weren't both. Nobody was both. You had to do one or the other. So, so I turned it down, and my... agent dropped me. My manager dropped me. They went,
my goodness!
Are you out of your mind? This is
Dallas.
This is this is going to be successful, which it was.
Right.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous money. You know, you're obviously not committed. You know, forget it. And they walked away. So I had nothing. So I had nothing to lose. So I started looking for partner, a band. And I met John in Berlin started, and that was 1979.
But did Dallas become a success before Berlin started?
No, it started
about the same time.
It took me a year to find John. That was 1978.
Okay.
That it started, and 1979 was when I joined.
Well, how did you meet John?
I answered his ad. His ad said,
"No way!
I have this band, and it's really unique." And I thought, "Okay, I like unique. I like different." And they were really different. I mean, electronic music was not happening in America yet. It was really more power pop, skinny ties, punk was happening in the late 70s. And mm-hmm. this was like, John was like into this whole like European thing that was Kraftwerk and Ultravox and
kind of glam.
With that glam kind of feeling, but he just loved the electronic thing. So that's what he was doing. And when I heard it, I was like, oh, this is cool. I'd never heard anything like this. So we just started playing the clubs in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And people laughed at us. I mean, they didn't get it.
What were you listening to then at that time?
I liked Bowie, I liked Pink Floyd, I liked Blondie, Talking Heads mm-hmm. were happening at the time, Television. Mm-hmm. I liked all the glam stuff.
Play CBGB back in New York?
Well, later.
Later,
yeah,
okay.
But yeah, not then, no.
Okay. Well, tell us about this clip that really put you on the map, Take My Breath Away.
The hit song.
Yeah,
what do you want to know about it?
Well, it's an interesting story from what I've researched, how you even got the song offered to you.
I wasn't the first. We were not even the fifth choice. We were nothing when that song came along. We were just in the right place at the right time. Giorgio Moroder wrote the song, he was producing one song on our record. We begged him to work with us. We were so in love with him because he had done Flashdance, Fame, he did Bowie's Putting Out Fire with Gasoline, he did Blondie's Call Me. He did, of course, Donna
successful.
Summer is how he started.
He was
started.
Very successful.
He was more than successful. He was like this sound. He was like Prince became. He was this guy that everybody came to sound like him, and he was electronic, and he was just amazing, but he was so expensive that we could only afford him for one song on a record. So he did No More Words, which became our first hit, of course, because he was so amazing. But because we were there doing that, he got the job to do Top Gun, to do the whole mm-hmm. soundtrack. So he asked many famous people, I mean, successful, you know, we didn't even have a hit yet. We were just kind of starting out. I think Martha Davis tried it out. A few people, mm-hmm. and the producers didn't like any of them. So he was like, well, what do you think? You want to do this song? You know, it's this movie. It's coming out next year. It's going to be, you know, Tom Cruise. And I was like, yeah. And John's like, no, I don't want to do that. It's not Berlin. We shouldn't do
it. Oh, really? You didn't like it?
We shouldn't do songs that aren't written by us. You know, we have to be Berlin. We have to be us. I was like, no, come on. It's Giorgio Moroder. You know, he could fart and I'd sing it. I'd love it. You know?
Great.
The record company came in and broke the stranglehold and said, you're doing it. I mean, this is a big deal. And this will, you know, get people to hear you that wouldn't hear you. So we did.
Well, let's watch.
That's great.
Let's watch the famous clip.
Yeah.
Take My Breath Away. talented Terri Nunn is with us. Tai.
So Take My Breath Away won the Academy Award in 1987. Mm-hmm. And yeah. Very good. And rumor has it that the Academy Award, I guess, producers wanted you to sing a smidgen of the hit.
Yes.
On the show.
On the show.
Yes.
Along with the other singers singing.
You're nominated.
Yeah. The contestants, right.
Right. The contestants. And you tell the story.
I said, well, I want to do the whole song, or I'm not going to do it. And the guy on the phone said, okay, thank you. Click.
And who ended up singing?
The girls.
I love that.
And I watched it on a little TV in Taiwan. We were doing a tour there in Taiwan, in the Olivision, and I was in Taiwan when I watched it win.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
So how, regrets?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was an idiot.
No, that's a hell yeah.
That's a hell yeah.
I mean, it's just
but you were 20 yeah. and.
But.
Yeah.
Terri,
yeah,
talk about the length of Berlin in terms of, you know, how long you've been on the scene and all the trials and tribulations. You guys have broken up how many times and come back how many times?
Well, I left in 81 and then got back with John in 82 and we got signed. I left again in 88. And then started it again in 98. And then it's been going since then.
Congratulations. How do you maintain that though? To stop, to start? You have new band members that come on?
For me, I left because I didn't know where to go with it. I mean, I just kind of got to a point where I was like, I don't know what to do now. And I didn't want to just redo the same old stuff.
Did it change after you had the hits? Did personalities change, which happens sometimes?
The record label just wanted us to do the same thing, you know, just
right.
do more of that.
Yeah, cookie cutter.
And yeah, mm-hmm. and for us, it was like, well, we did that. And I think my mistake, another regret, is I wanted to just try everything. I was like, well, let's do rock. So the third album was rock with Bob Ezrin, who did Pink Floyd's The Wall. I mean, he produced that one. And it's like, well, people are like, what's Berlin, you know, I mean, we like the electronic thing, that's what you did, and it just was so left turn that we lost a lot of people. It was, I now respect bands like Depeche Mode, who are what they are. They sound like the way they sound, mm-hmm. but they try new things and put in to what they are, and
right.
that, I think, is something that I've learned.
Well, as a performer, have you changed from back in the day to how you perform now?
God,
just
yeah.
as what specifically can you just nail?
I enjoy it more. I'm not so terrified. You know, it took
you appreciate it more.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It took me 30 years just to think that I was good. So there's a lot of fear, and now I know I'm never gonna suck. So I enjoy it more.
Yeah.
I'm able to look at people and just see, you know, what's going on.
Embrace
and
just, it.
Yeah, instead of being in my head and in my ego and do I look good and do I sound good, you must be there. I mean, don't you feel like you get to a point where you're past that and you can just enjoy the moment more?
Absolutely. It's easy to work, though, with time.
And how about with skating? Do you get there? I never got there with that.
What do you mean? Did I get?
With skating.
You know what? After I had Scout, after I became a mother, it got even better. And like I said, I appreciated it more and didn't take it. You know, in the 80s, I took a lot of stuff for granted. You know, there was a lot.
Why did it get better after being a mom?
I think because the focus was not so much
on you,
Tai and Randy.
Right.
And it's like I could perform for someone else.
Well, let's
that
focus
really counted.
On this next clip.
Okay.
The segment. Animal.
Yes.
Animal. I mean, what? I can't wait for everyone to see this.
It's hot.
It's hot. And tell us about where this was done. It's quite an interesting story.
Yeah.
Where it was shot.
Well, it was shot in a working dungeon in downtown LA. The director knew the lady she was a dominatrix and she owns this dungeon. And I mean, the song is just about getting out of my head and into my body and just feeling things from a completely, you know, physical, sensual place, and this place was fun.
I know.
You guys decided everything. Cages and whips and all kinds of just fun stuff. You know, it's very physical, very weird and
the animalistic.
And, yeah.
Inside
yeah.
You.
It's a great. So I got, all my friends are in there. My niece is in there. My mom's best friend. She's 72.
Oh my God.
I wanted a range. I wanted people who were like from my niece who's 23 to Jackie who's 72. I mean, there's just a range of people in this video having a great time.
Well, let's watch Terri Nunn.
I love this.
Animal.
I love the song.
This is it. This is the CD that's out that everybody
can get. Yeah, she goes, there's my husband, there's my brother, it's a family affair.
Yeah.
It's great. So, Terri, what do you have coming up? I know you have shows coming up here in town.
Yes, there are Christmas shows because we have a Christmas album coming out next year.
Great.
So this will be the last shows that we're going to play live, the stuff that we're recording now.
Right.
The album coming out next year. So we have one just in this area. We have December 5th. At the Coach House in San Juan Capistrano.
Okay.
The 12th is the Canyon in the Green Hills. And then 19th is the Saban Theater in the MS.
Great.
Yeah,
and weren't you talking about getting together with your other bandmates?
Yes.
The original.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. The three.
Love
the original
that.
Three. John Crawford, who started the band in 1977. And he wrote, the main writer in the band, and David Diamond and I were the original three. They are coming to,
wow.
For the first time since 2003, we're all playing together at these shows.
Oh, that's great. I bet you do more. You're going to do more?
I hope so.
Yeah, I bet you will.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of bands come and go. Why do you think Berlin has been able to endure such a longevity?
I don't know.
You got to know something.
I don't know. I love it.
I think it's because of you.
I think it's just love and passion and, you know, because...
It shows, you can see in the video.
Yeah.
As well.
Thank you. I love it. I'm not bored with it yet, you know? I just keep finding new interesting.
If the money were good and you were
with
bored
it.
With it, would you still do it?
No.
It's so boredom. If you're bored, you're not going to stay with it.
Yeah, because people feel that. They know when you're bored.
They know when there's no passion there. Yeah.
I don't like going to a concert with the same people bored or just kind of going through the motions. It's not.
You got to tell people the story about. We only have about a minute and a half. You're seeing Grace Slick for the first time. I thought that. Look at that.
Oh my God.
Grace Slick from the Jefferson Airplane.
Yes,
Starship.
Right. She's the reason that I sing. When I saw Grace
Slick, my God.
I mean that. I remember I was 4 or 5 or 6 or something. I saw her on TV and she was just, you know, took her shirt off and just like, you know, she was just like no other woman ever, you know, that was going on. And
yeah.
And so she agreed to let me interview her.
On the radio.
My show in exchange for singing on, she was doing a Hurricane Katrina benefit song. So she asked me to sing on it. and she let me interview her at her home for 2 hours.
Get out.
And oh were my you,
did you,
God.
Were you dying?
Yes, I was dying. And her daughter was there, China.
Yeah. Oh, right.
And I said, well, let's ask your daughter, China, was Grace a good mom? And Grace, with her cigarettes, said, all right, I'm leaving. And she walked away.
Oh, my God.
And I got China in and I, you know, and asked her, like, was she a good mom? Sometimes.
Right.
Was she there for you?
Sometimes.
Mm-hmm. They went through rehab together.
Really?
Yes, at the same time.
And she's painting. Oh, she's still doing her
yeah,
art.
She doesn't care about saying all.
Right.
Terri,
right.
We've what? Got less than 30 seconds.
Oh, I just thank you to, for having me.
I'm so glad you came. I know being on tour, coming and visiting, I know it, you know, coming all the way from L.A., to come with us, and we surely
so
appreciate
exciting.
It, and we hope you come back. It went by too quickly.
Thank you so much. It was really fun.
And I didn't know the connection between you two. This is great. You got to get back on skates. That's what we
Terri,
have to get
please.
You onto.
Never going to happen.
Never?
Not when you're there.
It's no, it'll I'll help you. That's what I do.
All right. Well, thank you. Come back again. Thank you. Thank you. Well, that's our show for tonight. Terri Nunn, and for Tai Babilonia and our director Nick Freddy and the entire KBL crew, I'm Ken Boxer. Good night, everybody, and thank you so much. Thank you.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Terri Riken Realtor at Sotheby's, your broker with a personal touch. Palazzo Restaurant, where people don't leave hungry or thirsty. Harbor View Inn. Welcome to Santa Barbara's premier four-diamond luxury boutique oceanfront hotel. Wendy Foster, Santa Barbara and Montecito's premier clothing store. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. Via Rosa Inn, let us pamper you in international style. La Quinta Inn and Suites, conveniently located in downtown Santa Barbara. And by Taffy's Pizza, delivery, pickup, or dine-in. Woody's Bodacious Barbecue, voted best barbecue in Santa Barbara for over 30 years. Santa Barbara Bar, finally, nutritious, tastes great. Country Catering, Meat Market, and Deli. Their food not only fills your plate, it nourishes the soul. Jack's Bagels and Bistro, serving the very best food in a friendly and relaxed atmosphere. Quality food and genuine drinks. Jill's Place, where the locals go to eat. Lido's Takeout, serving the best Mexican food for over 30 years. Perfect Computers since 1990. Ice and Paradise, fun for the entire family. The Santa Barbara Access Card. The Ken Boxer Live musical theme by Mr. Michael J. Leslie. From all of us at Ken Boxer Live, I'm Baron Ron Heron. Good night, everyone.